mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
United Nations sounds the alarm over the deteriorating humanitarian crisis in Ukraine as President Volodymyr Zelensky rejects the evacuation corridors proposed by Russia. Philippine economic managers recommend a nationwide shift to COVID alert level 1 to cushion the economic impact of the Russia-Ukraine conflict. FEMA's Centers for Disease Control and Prevention lowers its COVID-19 travel advisory on the Philippines. And thousands march across the world to mark International Women's Day. We talk about the continued fight for gender equality and its importance in addressing the climate crisis with a country program manager of UN's We Empower Asia. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. For joining us, and for those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad to have you with us today. The top diplomats of Russia and Ukraine set to hold another round of talks in Turkey Thursday after a third meeting ended with no positive developments. In an interview with Reuters, Kremlin spokesman Dmitry Peskov said Moscow will immediately end its military operations if Kyiv meets several conditions it has laid out. The demands include Ukraine stopping its own military action, changing its constitution to enshrine neutrality, acknowledging Crimea as a Russian territory, as well as recognizing Donetsk and Lugansk as independent states. Ukraine, however, wants direct talks between President Volodymyr Zelensky and Russia's Vladimir Putin. Efforts to implement humanitarian corridors also bogging down. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky has rejected Russia's proposal to evacuate Ukrainians into what he says are occupied territories. Zelensky describes Russia's proposal as plain propaganda. Russia had proposed the establishment of humanitarian corridors to allow civilians to leave 5 Ukrainian cities, including the capital, Kyiv. But most of these corridors would travel through Russia or Belarus. United Nations members sounding the alarm over the rapidly deteriorating humanitarian crisis in Ukraine.
We need Russia's firm, clear, public, and unequivocal commitment to allow and facilitate immediate, unhindered humanitarian access for humanitarian partners in Ukraine. Very specifically, we call for the Russian Federation to agree to and honor in good faith Ukrainian proposals for time-bound humanitarian safe passage in specific agreed-upon locations. Ukrainian cities are under siege, under relentless Russian shelling. Hospitals are running out of supplies, food is dwindling, and civilian casualties are mounting, while the most vulnerable group, those with disabilities, the elderly, children, continue to bear the brunt of suffering.
The U.S. planning a ban on Russian oil imports to further tighten the pressure on Moscow. And as this report tells us, the Biden administration is prepared to move alone on this, even without the participation of its European allies. Details in this report.
In a move to further punish Russia for its invasion of Ukraine, the United States is considering a ban on Russian oil imports without the participation of allies in Europe. Two people familiar with the matter told Reuters Monday. The White House is said to be negotiating with U.S. congressional leaders who are working on fast-tracking legislation. Though White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki said there's no decision yet.
Well, no decision has been made at this point by the president about a ban on importing oil from Russia. And those discussions are ongoing internally and also with our counterparts and partners in Europe and around the world.
President Joe Biden Monday tried to press his case in a video conference call with the leaders of France, Germany, and the United Kingdom. But Germany, the biggest buyer of Russian crude oil, has so far rejected pressure for a ban. The United States, which has imposed a host of painful sanctions against the Russian economy, President Vladimir Putin, and many Russian billionaires since the invasion began, has stopped short of targeting Russia's oil and gas, worried it could drive energy prices even higher. Oil prices have soared to levels not seen since 2008, and Americans are getting sticker shock at the pump. But some don't mind if it means condemning Russia.
As far as I'm concerned, we should raise the gas price. Stop importing oil from Russia and put the hurt on them. It's going to make inflation go up even higher, but we've got to do what we've got to do.
Meanwhile, Axios reported that President Biden might make a trip to Saudi Arabia as the United States seeks to get Riyadh to increase energy production. A White House official didn't deny the report, but said it was premature speculation and that nothing was planned yet.
The European Union is set to phase out its imports of Russian gas, oil, and coal in the wake of the country's invasion of Ukraine. That task will be tough, though, as the bloc depends on Russia for about 45% of its imported gas and around a third of its oil. The leader of the EU also planned to diversify their energy supplies by using liquefied natural gas and by developing biogas and hydrogen. As for Russia, it warns a ban on their oil imports will have catastrophic consequences. It has also threatened to cut natural gas supplies to Europe via the Nord Stream 1 pipeline in retaliation to the West sanctions. Russia's deputy prime minister adds they have other options for the sale of their oil if the U.S. and the EU push through with a ban. At home, Philippine economic managers are recommending a nationwide shift to COVID alert level 1 to cushion the possible effects of the Russia-Ukraine conflict on the economy. Finance Secretary Carlos Dominguez says while the war does not have a direct impact on the Philippines, the economy may incur what he calls collateral damage.
It is as if we are hit by a ricocheting bullet. These indirect shocks are likely to be felt through four major channels: the commodity market, the financial market, investments, and the impact on our fiscal health. I would like to emphasize that we do not expect this crisis to last very long. However, there may be some lingering effects. We have seen similar crises in the past, such as the Gulf War in 1990, the Asian financial crisis in 1997, the oil price shock of 2008, and also the first Russia-Ukraine conflict in 2014. And we have weathered all of these crises very well.
The government's economic team is suggesting 14 measures to alleviate the impact of the crisis, among them opening all schools for face-to-face classes to increase domestic economic activity and doubling the fuel subsidy program for public utility vehicle drivers to 5 billion pesos.
While we cannot prevent the risk from coming from the global perspective, we can strengthen our domestic economy to provide the people with more jobs and opportunities.
More Filipinos evacuated from Ukraine have arrived in the Philippines. 21 Filipinos, all crew members of bulk carrier MVS Breeze, arrived at the Ninoy Aquino International Airport Tuesday morning. They requested repatriation due to the worsening situation in Ukraine. This is the third batch of repatriates from Ukraine, and more Filipinos are expected to travel back home after the Philippine Foreign Affairs Department raised the alert level over Ukraine to 4. This means the DFA will enforce the mandatory evacuation of Filipinos in Ukraine. They will be assisted by the Philippine Embassy in Poland. Despite mandatory evacuation, some Filipinos are choosing to stay in Ukraine. Among them, a Filipino worker married to a Ukrainian national. She says she cannot simply pack her bags and leave her family behind. She also shares basic commodities are running out of the capital, Kyiv, where they are currently living.
So far, meron pa po kami tubig, pero yung gamot po ng maintenance ng inlo ko, wala na po kasi sirado po yung mga pharmacy dito. Pagkain, mahirapan din po din paghanap kasi yung malapit na mga maliit na store namin dito, either sirado na siya or wala na siyang stock. Kailangan namin pumunta sa medyo malalayo, pero risky po siya.
An update from the campaign trail. Let's head on over to Quezon City now, where presidential candidate Leody de Guzman and his running mate, Professor Walden Bello, join a rally to mark International Women's Day. ABS-CBN's Mike Navalio on the line now with an update. Mike?
Hi, Carmina. Presidential candidate Leody de Guzman and Vice Presidential bet Walden Bello attended this morning a protest action organized by women's and progressive groups at the Quezon City Hall on the occasion of International Women's Day. De Guzman and Bello touted their tandem as the only one providing concrete measures for the protection of women. Among these measures, pushing for the legalization of divorce and same-sex marriage, as well as the criminalization of abortion. Calling their campaign as one for the cultural liberation of women, Bello said it's time to free women from the bondage of loveless marriages while removing the criminal liability for divorce will encourage women to seek safer measures and avoid unnecessary death due to underground procedures. Bello said that around 1,000 women out of the 600,000 who secure abortion die each year. Bello was among the authors of the reproductive health bill. Laments that while the bill was passed into law, it has yet to be fully implemented since 2013 due to opposition from the Catholic Church. He said it's time for women to have access to contraceptives and for them to decide what to do with their bodies, not Catholic bishops who are all male. The Guzman, meanwhile, reiterated his support for same-sex marriage. He confirmed his son Dexter's statement last night in an interview with Boy Abunda. A Labor leader was very supportive of him being a member of the LGBTQIA plus community, that he didn't even have to come out to his father and didn't feel any discrimination from his family and friends. The Guzman said he learned to respect individual sexual orientation and gender identity while working at a factory. The presidential candidate also expressed his support for raising the age of consent, sexual consent, from 12 to 16 years old, saying 12 is too young to be able to fully understand a person's sexuality. Aside from De Guzman and Bello, senatorial candidates Luke Espiritu and David DeAngelo also attended the protest action with some 300 members of Oriang, Partido Lakas ng Masa, San Lakas ng Bukluran ng mga manggagawang Pilipino. The group then marched around the elliptical circle before boarding some vehicles for motorcade. De Guzman, Bello, and Espiritu are set to begin this Friday multi-city visits in Mindanao, beginning in Ozamiz City all the way to Davao City. Bello is currently facing a 10 million peso cyber libel rap filed by the former City Information Officer of Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte over statements that link Jeffrey Cubas to a drug raid. Bello said the complaint is politically motivated and claimed it is meant to deflect attention from Duterte's refusal to attend a public debate. Bello will hold a press con this afternoon on the same issue to this afternoon. Carmina?
Thanks a lot. Mike Navarro there joining us on the line. Moving on, the Commission on Elections is set to launch an accessible polling precinct for persons with disabilities in Cainta and Rizal as part of its bid to raise the participation of vulnerable sectors in the May polls. Our correspondent Jervis Manahan now joins us on the line with more details. Jervis, over to you.
Carmina, the Commission on Elections has launched three new sites as accessible polling places for persons with disabilities this coming election. The three sites include Tahanang Walang Hagdan in Cainta, Rizal, Hospicio de San Jose in Manila, and the National Vocational Center in Quezon City. In Tahanang Walang Hagdan, 87 persons with disabilities will be voting come election day. Aside from these sites, 2,100 voting centers will also have emergency accessible polling places. These are rooms located in the ground floor for multi-story precincts and centers located in uphill areas that will be used by PWDs, pregnant women, and senior citizen voters. According to the COMELEC, more than 511,000 voters in the upcoming polls are PWDs. The Vulnerable Sector Office of the COMELEC conducted a voter education forum where they answered questions from workers of Tahanang Walang Hagdan. Sector Head Maureen Ava Mata encourages PWDs around the country to go out and vote on Election Day. Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Jervis. Take care and you keep safe. Well, the tandem of Bongbong Marcos and Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio brings their campaign to the vote-rich province of Bulacan. Our correspondent, Ina Reformina, on the line now with the latest from there. Ina.
Yes, Casey, after resting yesterday from physical campaigning, Unity in Tandem Bongbong Marcos and Sara Duterte are here in Bulacan to win some 2.007 million voters, registered voters here in the province. They just finished with their Giginto led, their Giginto campaign led, which was held at the Giginto Municipal Oval. The oval was filled, KC, but we don't have the crowd estimate yet from the local police. Now, Bongbong Marcos spoke about continuing the build program of President Rodrigo Duterte. Also, he stressed his economic recovery plan, the backbone of which is support for MSMEs. He said that MSMEs are among the worst hit by the COVID-19 pandemic, and to target MSMEs in his economic recovery plan would greatly benefit the economy and give the economy its needed boost. Meantime, Sara Duterte also spoke about supporting quality education as well as following through with the peace and order campaign of his father, President Rodrigo Duterte. Now, here in Giginto, Casey, there are 75,003 voters. After this Giginto leg, they will proceed to Maguayan. There are 128,237 voters. And the last rally that they will be having in their day-long Bulacan campaign will be in Santa Maria, which has 132,380 voters. Now, in Hanlalan, in the 2016 elections, Marcos obtained 42.50% of votes for vice president, compared to Robredo's 27.95%, so 556,480 Bulaqueños voted for Marcos in Hanlalan in 2016 in his vice presidential bid. Also joining the Unity presidential and vice presidential tandem are their senatorial candidates, Gingoy Estrada, Rodante Marcoleta, Gringo Onasan, Harry Roque, Mark Villar, Larry Gadon, Herbert Bautista, and Lauren Regarda. They were also joined by Robin Padilla. They were greeted by local officials, not only from Giginto, but from the rest of the province as well, from mayors and vice mayors and congressmen as well from Bulacan. Also, Vice Governor Wilhelmino C. was among those who greeted them here in their rally. So again, a day-long campaign activity for the presidential and vice presidential front runners, Marcos and Duterte, and their vice and their senatorial slate, rather here in the vote-rich province of Bulacan. That is the latest from Bulacan. KC, back to you.
Thanks a lot, Ina. Take care and you keep safe. Aksyon Demokratiko Standard Bearer Manila Mayor Isko Moreno wooing voters in Tarlac. Let's get details now from our correspondent, Bianca Dava. Bianca, go ahead.
Hi, Carmina. Day 59 of the official campaign for national candidates brought the Aksyon Demokratiko here in Tarlac Province. Party standard bearer Mayor Isko Moreno Dumagoso, his running mate Dr. Willie Ong, and senatorial candidates Jopet Tison, Carl Balita, and Samira Gutok are all present. The party is currently holding a motorcade in the towns of Concepcion, Capas, Tarlac City, and Bamban. Earlier, Moreno and his plate visited a shopping center in Concepcion where they were warmly greeted by supporters and mall goers. Their arrival actually caused a commotion inside the community mall. The mayor was supposed to shut the vaccination site at the shopping center but did not push through as security personnel were having a hard time controlling the crowd. Dr. Willie Ong, who sustained an injury after falling off their campaign float in Bataan last week, even attended to a senior citizen who experienced difficulty breathing after getting stuck in the crowd. A few moments from now, there will be a media event at the Tarlac Provincial Capital where we are expecting to interview Moreno and his plate about their campaign and other issues. Later this afternoon, Moreno will hold a dialogue with ground leaders, volunteers, and supporters in Pura Town. And in the evening, the Moreno Ong tandem will hold a campaign rally in Tarlac City. Carmina, this is the party's second visit to the province of Tarlac, the first during the official campaign period. It was in Tarlac City where Moreno first bared his plan for tax cuts on oil and electricity presidency during his listening tour last October. Carmina?
Thanks a lot, Bianca Dava, there joining us. Take care, Bianca. Keep safe. And back here for more news, Cavite Representative Boying Remulla remains on the Philippines' trending list on Twitter. That's after coming under fire for saying those who attended a huge campaign rally for Vice President Lenny Robredo over the weekend in his home province were paid. The lawmaker also accused some of the youth attendees of having links to the communist movement. In an interview on this show, Remulla also mentioned a Sambayan senatorial bet, Neri Colmenares, as proof that there is an alliance between Robredo and the CPP-NPA-NDF. Joining us now, Attorney Neri Colmenares. Attorney Neri?
Hi, good noon. Program.
Thanks for joining us today.
Good noon po sa viewers din ninyo. Thank you.
All right, so on this program, as I said, Congressman Remulla said that the student activists present in the Cavite rally over the weekend were NDF trained. First of all, your reaction to that, Attorney Colmenares?
Well, definitely, it's not true. Red tagging, of course, is a very dangerous allegation and you must have evidence to back it up. But I am sure many of the, even I think, Bongbong supporters would say, anybody who comes in and makes allegation, tapos sabay sabihin, hindi ko na kailangan patunayan yan, wala agad credibility yan, di ba? Pangalawa, ni hindi niya alam na hindi nga ako part ng 12 Senate slate ni Lenny Robredo. So can you trust a person who got his facts wrong, right? So akin, very indignant ng mga taong yung mamamayan at mga taga-Cavite because it resulted in two things. First, he insulted the Caviteños na parang, bayaran kayo, di ba? You go to rallies just because bayaran kayo when in fact it's not true. The second is, ininsulto niya ang kabataan. Just because they're supporting Lenny, CPP, NPA, red tag na sila. Just because I spoke in the stage against Bongbong Marcos, you know, biglang na-red tag na rin ako. I mean, kasama naman kami ng ilang term sa Kongreso, hindi naman niya sinasabi yon.
Pero in fact, ngayon, this is what he said, Attorney Colmenares. He said that proof of the VP's endorsement proof of this alliance between the VP and the CPP-NPA-NDF is her endorsement of your candidacy. Your reaction to that?
Of course, it's baseless. So, porket in-endorse ako ni VP Lenny Robredo, then CPP-NPA. And secondly, sinabi ko nga na hindi nga ako isang bayan senatorial slate ako. Pero may 12 slate naman si VP Lenny eh. So even his facts were wrong. At ito ang problema sa Marcos camp, kila Bongbong Marcos. They resort to this kind of subterfuge, yung ganitong klaseng underhanded campaign. Kaya Bongbong Marcos should should be, you know, should go to debates, debate with Vice President Lenny Robredo, rather than order his minions to attack the Vice President. Eh siya, pag presidente ka, dapat matapang ka. Hindi ka dapat duwag sa debate, ordering your minions to attack the Vice President, red tagging, bayaran, without any evidence, is of course an indictment. But you know what, Carmina? Red tagging, to be fair to President Duterte, he did not start red tagging. It was Marcos Sr., President Marcos, who started red tagging. In fact, he red tagged activists. He red tagged opposition members. In fact, I remember Senator Ninoy Aquino was convicted by a military commission and sentenced to death on the basis of criminal subversion and murder. So Marcos actually started this during martial law. And I wouldn't be surprised if Marcos Jr. himself will employ the same red tagging tactics, only to stymie the opposition, silence the opposition, stifle dissent, just because, oh, they want the youth to be fearful na, oh, red tag na tayo, huwag na tayong sumuporta kay Lenny Robredo. Well, they're wrong. The youth and students will continue to support VP Lenny no matter what they say, because VP Lenny, sa pagtingin ng kabataan, is the best presidential candidate. And I'm sure itong pagpanik ng Marcos camp, sa laki, nagulat sila sa embarrassing sa kanila, sa laki ng mga rallies ni VP Lenny Robredo, they have to resort to this kind of underhanded tactics. So,
Attorney Neri, sorry to cut you there, but let me just go back to what Congressman Boyeng Remulla said. How does that not run counter to the call of Marcos Jr. for unity? I mean, this is the core of his campaign. And yet, with the statement of Congressman Boyeng Remulla, it seems to provoke, even promote polarization among the
Correct.
People.
Actually, Marcos is a presidential candidate who will foment disunity. Why did I say that? In the first place, his father, during martial law, was an epitome of disunity. Kasi Marcos excluded anybody who disagrees with him during martial law. Intolerant siya sa dissent. All opposition, ayaw mo mag-agree sa akin, kulong ka, patay ka, kasuhan ka. The same thing with Marcos now. And he's saying unity, unity, but he is actually the symbol of disunity and exclusion. Look at this example. Porket aktivista yung isang kabataan, therefore CPP NPA. Porket sumusuporta sila kay VP Lenny Robredo, therefore CPP NPA. So, wala silang tolerance sa dissent. Eh, nagdi-disagree sa kanila. Hindi boboto kay Bongbong Marcos. Then you endanger our lives, the lives of the youth and students, and the opposition, by merely alleging, sabihin nyo, hindi na namin kailang patunayan yan, that they are the CPP NPA, they are red tag, just like that. And many have died of red tagging, Carmina.
So then what to you is the goal of Congressman Remulla for saying all these things?
Well, I think this is just an attack from the Marcos camp, of course, through Mr. Remulla, to discredit the Vice President and all those who support her. Kami sa Makabayan, we support Lenny Robredo because not only do we have common views sa plataforma para sa mamamayan, para sa manggagawa, magsasaka, but also she's in the best position to defeat Marcos. And the way they're attacking VP Lenny now is a sign of panic within the Marcos camp dahil may momentum si VP Lenny Robredo. But ganito na lang, kung gusto niyong manalo si VP Lenny, si Marcos Cavite, then you campaign for Bongbong Marcos. Do not resort to allegations na unfounded allegation. May bayaran dyan, CPP, NPA niyan. Kasi ang tao hindi naniniwala sa red tagging, lalo pang ma-discredit kayo at lalo pang ma-expose si Bongbong Marcos and his camp na human rights violator, because red tagging is a human rights, is a form of violation of rights, right? So,
But this whole red tagging issue, Attorney Colmenares, I mean, this didn't happen overnight. It may have happened over the weekend to some of those who attended the rally, but for you and the Makabayan Bloc, this has long been happening. In fact, this is one of the reasons why there was this seeming distrust of you. And that's why you weren't included in the Senate slate of the Robredo campaign. Why can't you seem to shake this tag off?
Well, you see, ang red tagging naman nila has been going on for some time now. Not just us in Makabayan, celebrities, universities, movie stars, even community pantry, Carmina. So, alam na ng taong bayan yan. And I think, yung taong bayan, tinignan naman talaga nila si Nery Colmenares. Ano pong ginawa ni Nery Colmenares? Did he kill anybody? Did he shoot anybody? Wala akong sinasaktan, di ba? And track record ko lang naman titingnan nila, nilaban ang dagdag na SSS pension, nilaban ang disaster alert law. I mean, all these things I did during Congress, and even the Marcos camp would know this, were all for the benefit of the Filipino people. So whether they, if they continue their red tagging, then for me that's the wrong and a losing campaign strategy. Marcos as Jr. should campaign better by appearing in debates, by going and, you know, discussing with the media his platform of unity, rather than resorting to underhanded campaigns against VP Lenny Robredo without even himself doing that, but his minions doing it for him. So, hindi naman ganun tama. If he wants to charge VP Lenny Robredo, kami, kabataan, and Kabiteño, he should go out himself and charge us with that. Then we will debate him on the merits rather than he silently hides behind his supporters and minions to attack the vice president. The vice president did not commit anything wrong. She went to Cavite, the Cabiteño supported her. Many of us went there with her. And that is a fact that the Marcoses and Mr. Remulla should accept. And they cannot win this election if they continue to do this kind of besmirching reputations through the dangerous form of red tagging and alleging vote buying or bayaran ng mga hapot crowds.
A while ago, Attorney Ineri, you did say that, you know, when people look, dig deeper, they will see that it's not just dissent coming from your part, but this has actually paved the way for many pieces of legislation that you had furthered when you were a member of Congress. But when they do dig deeper still, Attorney Colmenares, will they also find that you had actually condoned the atrocities committed by the NPA?
No. In fact, I have, as a human rights lawyer, have always stated and said that any human rights violations committed by the NPA or whatever group should be condemned and opposed. We've always stated that since 2016, Carmina, we've stated that. And hindi na kailangang ulit-ulitin nila yan. Ano? Pero sige na, we've always challenged the government here. If you think we are committing a criminal act, file cases against us. Hindi naman nagsasampa ng kaso kasi wala naman nga silang ebidensya. And they just keep on alleging it to take out the progressive elements in Congress para matalo at hindi na, tinik kasi kami sa lalamunan nila eh. We are fiscalizers in Congress and they don't want another fiscalizer senator in the Senate. So I'm very sorry for our dogs. But,
it's all right. It's okay. Go ahead. Continue.
Well, that's the reason being kasi the red tagging is to stifle dissent, to silence people. Eh, hindi kami nasa-silence. So they keep on repeating that until such time when we feel afraid na wag na lang kasi ma-red tag tayo, marami nang namatay. Bloody Sunday in Cavite, you know, that was an issue of people, Manny Asuncion, for example, red tag and then killed. That's why the Supreme Court had to intervene in the end to regulate search warrants, precisely because many of the victims of red tagging were killed on the guise of the execution of search warrants. So yeah, I guess people will see behind these kinds of red tagging, and I'd like to take it back to the presidential candidate of the Marcos camp. Your father did red tagging way back during martial law. Please do not do it again, because even if your father red tagged people during martial law, the Filipino people, one fateful day of February 1986, stood up and said enough. And then one of the most powerful dictators in the world was overthrown by the Filipino people. So do not ever attempt to use that same tactic against the Filipino people and against the opposition, because it will not work. It will, in fact, ensure your defeat if you commit human rights violations and the rights of others in the way of your campaigning.
You just answered my final question right there, because I was going to ask you that earlier. You said the goal was to discredit the campaign of the vice president. And I was going to ask you if you think that the goal will succeed, but you just said it, that it won't.
Succeed. In fact, Marcos's campaign tactic is the one that is not succeeding. Any campaign that is based on false narratives and fake news is a weak campaign. The moment you expose the falsity of the narratives, the entire campaign of Bongbong Marcos will crumble. And that will ensure his defeat.
Isambayan senatorial candidate Nery Colmenares there. Attorney Nery, always a pleasure talking to you. Thanks for joining us today. Take care and you keep safe.
Yes, thanks.
All right, from there, we're going to take a break now. Up ahead, protests held in parts of the world to mark the International Women's Day. Details of that story and more when Dateline Philippines returns. Stay with us here on ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Thank you.
And back, there's still a Dateline Philippines here on ANC. Here's another look at our headlines this noon. The United Nations sounds the alarm over the deteriorating humanitarian crisis in Ukraine as President Volodymyr Zelensky rejects the evacuation corridors proposed by Russia. Philippine economic managers recommend a nationwide shift to COVID alert level 1 to cushion the impact of the Russia-Ukraine conflict. The U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention lowers its COVID-19 travel advisory on the Philippines. And thousands march across the world to mark International Women's Day. Bolivia and Mexico call for an end to femicide as they mark International Women's Day. Bolivian feminist groups took to the streets of La Paz to demand justice for victims of gender-based violence. Hundreds marched to the city's Court of Justice building, calling for a speedier resolution of cases of violence against women. Bolivia has one of South America's highest rates of women being killed because of their gender. More than 100 femicides were reported in the country in 2021. In Mexico, a blimp denouncing the high number of femicides flew over the capital city. The 50-meter-long blimp read, 10 femicides per day, no victim is forgotten. An anonymous group flew that blimp to demand justice for the families of the victims. Various women's groups in the Philippines taking to the streets to mark International Women's Day. In Quezon City, the local arm of World March of Women held a rally calling on Filipinos to vote for leaders that will promote women's rights. In Manila, dozens marched to protest various issues, including the big jump in oil prices. The crowd was supposed to make its way to the Mendiola Peace Arch, but they were stopped by the police. Well, today, we celebrate International Women's Day, but as we honor women all across the globe, we must recognize that the many adversities that they too face. According to the United Nations, women and girls from the world's poorest and most marginalized communities who contribute the least to climate change suffer the most from its effects. And to know this is to pave the path forward towards sustainable climate action for humanity in its entirety. Let's talk about gender equality and its importance in addressing the climate crisis. Joining us today, United Nations Philippines We Empower Asia Country Manager, Rosalyn Messina. Happy International Women's Day to you, Rosalyn. Welcome to the program and thanks for joining us today.
Yes, happy International Women's Day to you, Carmina, and to your team. And thank you for having us in your program today.
All right, so when we talk about gender equality and the fight against climate change, the connection right there is not that clear. Let's first talk about the women and girls who are most vulnerable to climate change. Talk to us about this.
Yes, we want to really put a center, or we want to put women and girls at the center of climate crisis at this time. The International Women's Day, as we celebrate it, would usually discuss about achievements in the political, social, economic sphere. But I think this year, what we need to bring attention to is how women and girls are disproportionately impacted by the adverse effects of climate change. They are the first ones to really suffer from loss of homes, vulnerability to being out in the open with different possible perpetrators, trafficking, irregular migration, loss of livelihoods, their health and their health and you know, the children that they need to care for. I think what we need to understand is women suffer more when we have climate crisis and when we fail to address it, incorporating their real concerns and situations.
And we need not look far, Rosalyn, to see evidence of this. Take, for instance, what happened to the areas devastated by Typhoon Odette. Give us specific scenarios as to where the disaster put women and children, how much of a risk were they surrounded by post the typhoon visiting the country.
Yes. Typhoon Odette, a very recent example for us when women would lost their houses. They would not have access to a place where they would be able to secure their family and their children. There's no access to clean water that they would use to prepare and provide food for their children and their family, and to also make sure that they themselves are well taken care of, are healthy and hygienic. And this is what we're missing out in a lot of humanitarian actions, that usually it's blanket support and blanket distribution of goods and supplies, but we missed out on providing what the women need. They need supplies that would allow them to provide water for their children, food that they would need to feed them, and sanitary napkins for those, because the period will not stop even if they are not in their homes and even if they do not have access to clean water. So we really want to make sure that humanitarian actors, donors, and supporters would have this in mind. Outside that, I think what we also need is to hear them out in terms of what they can really do to be part of the action that needs to happen in addressing climate crisis. So having their voice heard and having their ideas on how to address it and support them in building resilient and adaptive communities is very crucial as well.
Yeah, Roslyn, can you hear me?
Yes, Carmina, sorry. You're breaking up a bit.
Yeah, so even the simple energizing a community, for example, or sending solar lamps in the absence of electricity post a disaster, that to some spells a difference between life and death, or being safe and being in constant danger. A lot of people really don't know about the importance of that. Talk to us about that and how this basically ensures the safety of women and girls post a disaster.
Yes, it is very crucial for them to be able to have access to well-lighted spaces, because in dark spaces, they could be more vulnerable to abuses, especially sexual abuses and exploitation that could happen, especially post-disaster scenario or situation. And this is where we also want to really highlight the importance of setting up, private restrooms that women could access safely, especially well-lighted places or well-lighted pathway that would provide them a safe place to use to go and access these restrooms and places of places where they need to do their personal stuff.
Yeah, but Rosalind, when we talk about effects and necessary climate action, we're not just talking about post-disaster here, because climate change is not a one-time, big-time event. Climate change is creeping. So talk to us about the necessary policies here that are needed to be able to address this. Because as I said, it's not just about the one-time, big-time disaster that hits a particular area.
Necessary policies should really be in alignment with how the international community is really pushing for each country to put in place proper mechanisms that would allow for commitments in the climate compact in the world. And we need to first make an enabling environment for increasing women's participation in how these policies would be shaped. We want also businesses and communities that there would really be enough representation of women in how we would develop these policies, recovery action plans and programs as well. I think it's so crucial for us to have consultations with women and girls and hear about their stories, hear about their challenges, and make sure that in whatever policy that we would craft, we would be able to incorporate their issues and concerns, and they would be able to have a platform to voice their issues and concerns as well.
So this means you got to have more women in place to craft these policies, more women in the workplace to make sure that the women, thrive in these workplaces, that they stay and they thrive in these workplaces. You got to have more women in the farmlands and make sure that they have bountiful harvests. And that should come not just from our sector, right? it's got to come from across all sectors, Roslyn.
We need to have champions in every place. I think we cannot always be talking about gender equality and women's empowerment and only hear about only hear from women who are championing this change. We need everyone to take this seriously and everyone to champion this issue. I am really delighted to see more and more taking on and taking action on these areas and really being very vocal about what they are doing to promote gender inclusive workplaces, to recognize how they can facilitate women's participation and provide flexible work arrangements to women who need it. Make sure that they are also provided the opportunity to grow and to thrive in whatever career they would want to do. And yes, see more champions honing and creating pathways for other women and girls to move forward and be what they want to be and, you know, maximize and really meet their fullest potential.
Because when this happens, Roslyn, it's not just the women who are going to benefit, right?
Exactly.
Who else will benefit from this?
Everyone, I would say. And this is really our call, that we, when we all promote gender equality, women and girls, when we pave pathways for them, they will create a positive impact and would provide us really a solution to a sustainable future for everyone, an inclusive and sustainable development that we could all benefit from.
Well, Roslyn Messina, UN Women Philippines Program Manager for We Empower Asia. Happy International Women's Day to you. It was a pleasure talking to you. Thanks
Thank
again.
Thank you so much, Carmina. Happy International Women's Day and have a good day.
You too. Take care.
Yes. Keep safe.
Appreciate it. The U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention lowers its COVID-19 travel advisory on the Philippines and several other destinations to alert a level 3. The CDC placed the Philippines on its highest travel alert at level 4 last month amid an Omicron-fueled surge. Alert level 4 recommends avoiding travel to that destination. The Philippine Energy Department sees another oil price hike happening next week. Attorney Rino Abad of the Oil Industry Management Bureau says a rollback is unlikely at this point in time, given the OPEC's refusal to increase oil production, thinning inventory, and the ongoing conflict between Russia and Ukraine.
We are inclined to say na baka sa susunod na linggo talagang mataas kagaya pa rin ngayon. Yung kasing taas pa rin ngayon ang mangyayaring adjustment. Habang hindi nababago yung apat na yun na sinabi ko, ini-expect po talaga natin, unfortunately, na tataas pa po ang price.
Legally speaking, Senator Franklin Drilon says there is no reason why the Finance Department cannot suspend the collection of fuel excise taxes as a form of relief for Filipinos. According to Drilon, the train law provides the DOF the elbow room it needs to adjust for when crude prices exceed $80 a barrel. And before we go, we have this piece of breaking news. A Cebu Pacific plane has been involved in a runway accident at the Ninoy Aquino International Airport Terminal 3. No details about the accident were given, but the budget carrier shared the Cebu flight DG6112 came from Naga. It added its immediate priority is to ensure the safety of its passengers and crew on board. Stay with ANC for more on this developing story. That'll do it for today. Thank you for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, you can play back this newscast on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on the News Channel.